In this tutorial, I'll be showing you some tips and tricks for processing your RAW files inside of Capture One in preparation for retouching in Photoshop. Hey there, Michael Volshinovich here from Vibrant Shot. You can find me on Facebook and Instagram via the links below and also at vibrantshot.com. So in today's tutorial, we're going to be looking at how to get the most out of your RAW files inside of Capture One in anticipation of retouching in Photoshop. So it's going to be about finding a balance point at which your image looks good, but also retains enough of that sort of original essence that you can work with it inside of Photoshop. So we don't really want a complete image in Capture One. If you want sort of a more complete process, I do have a video on sort of start to finish portrait retouching in Capture One. Here, our goal is really to get the best we can out of the RAW file and then finish up our work inside of Photoshop. So we're going to be working on this image here today. And this is sort of a completed version of our image. Now, if we look at the original, these are shot with a phase one. So the phase one RAW files are, as it's described, very raw. So although it looks good here, this is kind of what it looks like coming out of the camera. And obviously we have a little bit of work to do in order to massage it to a point where we don't have to fix a ton of stuff in Photoshop, because that's the great thing about Capture One, is it gets you a good chunk of the way there without actually having to do as much legwork in Photoshop later. So generally where we're going to start, and this is generally where I advise that you'd always start, is on the white balance side of things. Now, if you have a gray card, just measure out the gray card. I did have a gray card here, but for me, I don't know, sometimes I find even when we have a gray card, it doesn't quite, you know, render correctly for me. So for me, usually the gray card is more of a starting point, and then I sort of nudge things one way or another. So in order to get our white balance, we're gonna go into our color tab here. And if you're not too familiar with Capture One, be sure to check out my getting started video on Capture One. So the first thing we're gonna do, I know that my strobes generally are almost always at like 5450, 5500 Kelvin. So I'm going to just start at 5450. If we get the Kelvin right, it's a lot easier to just have the one slider, the tint slider to deal with to get sort of that, you know, green magenta sorted out, as opposed to having to sort of balance the two. So for me, I know that that's my starting point. Again, if you have a gray card, just measure it off that. For the tint, we're gonna just kind of, you know, I keep nudging until I see it looking sort of the way I want to. Now, one thing that you may find too is that as we start going, you know, right here around four is probably a pretty good point, although you're probably thinking, you know, wow, that still doesn't look very good. It won't until we actually start working with the color editor. And that's something that I always end up using, even when I'm shooting tethered. I sort of set things up with a basic color editor profile for the skin tones, and then things start to look a lot better. So fear not, we'll get there. So we're going to start at around four. I don't know if I want to push it too much more, because then it's going to start to feel a little too magenta. So I think, around, let's maybe take it to 4.5 here. And sometimes it's just easier to type this out than trying to use the slider. So that's where we're going to start. Now, if I was shooting tethered, generally what I would do is I would just use, you know, the skin tone color editor here. We'll sample something on the skin. And then, you know, as soon as we use uniformity, as you can see, things are starting to look better already. We just have to adjust hue and saturation. We're not going to do that in this case, because I'll tell you what the problem is with using sort of a blanket color editor like this, is that if we start playing with this uniformity, take a look at the lips and see what happens. If we push it to here, that pink lip now becomes a lot more sort of, you know, it's a light pink, sort of desaturated pink. It's got a lot more orange to it. Because essentially what's happening is this is the sort of swath of color that we're trying to cover with our color editor. So this is kind of what it identified as potential skin tones. And obviously the lip color is encroaching on that. Now, if you had a blue lip, you're not going to have to worry, but you know, that's kind of rare. Usually lips are pink, peach, red, all things that we really find inside the skin. So although this is fine when we're actually tethering, because I just want it to kind of, you know, look good, and obviously when I'm tethering, the model is in a different position every time, so we can't use things like masking. When we're preparing, however, we're going to use a mask so that we can be a little bit more accurate in this process. So I'm just going to revert this back, and we're going to get there on the local adjustment side of things. So the next thing I want to do is, once I've got my white balance more or less set up, then I'm going to go into my exposure tab, and let's just play with the exposure a little bit. So first thing I want to do is just nudge up our exposure, because this is slightly underexposed in my mind. So we're going to push it to, let's say, we'll add, man, around that much should be a good starting point, and then maybe a little bit less. Let's do 0.35. There we go. So essentially a third of a stop is what I'm going to add to this. Next thing I'm going to do, once we increase the exposure, we can see that the contrast is not quite where I'd like it to be. And for me, the best way to add contrast is to actually use the levels. I don't tend to use the contrast slider itself. Only time I do use the contrast slider is if you've got sort of a high key image shot on white and you've got a little bit of flare coming back, then I find that the contrast at around 2 or 3, you know, up to 4, does a nice job of recovering some of that. For something like this, I generally don't tend to use it. So what I do use are these sort of handle points at the bottom of the level. So if we start nudging this one, you're going to see that it's going to start taking the shadow point and moving it around. So we're going to do that. We're going to move it to around 3 here. And then we're going to take this guy and we're going to sort of add some contrast in our highlights. So I'm going to take this to about 250 or so. And I'm actually going to nudge, I think, this back up to 0.4. So let's do that. And I think now that and it's always kind of a balancing point. Once you start playing around with these things, you can go back here and start to play around with it a little bit as well. We can pull our shadow slider. We're going to just pull that a little bit to pull out some shadow. Now, you're probably thinking, well, what was the point in that if you started playing around with the contrast here? It does a nice job of kind of balancing those two things out. So even though I do want a little bit more of that shadow detail back, by recovering the shadow detail and using this in combination, I'm getting a little bit more contrast and pulling in a bit more shadow detail. So another thing I like to do is use the new clarity option here, even though, you know, in Lightroom, you should really never use clarity on a portrait. Same with Adobe Camera Raw. If you use it there, it just starts to look really unnatural and unflattering. But Capture One has actually done a pretty good job of having this natural clarity method, which actually works quite well on portraits if you use it sparingly. So we're going to actually nudge this to around 3. I find it gives just a little bit more sharpness, a little bit of sort of specularity, sort of micro contrast. And at the same time, it doesn't really push things to the point where they look unnatural. It's just, you know, when you look at the skin texture, it just looks a little bit crisper. So don't go too far with that. Around 3 to 5 is kind of where I stick to. So next thing we're going to do is we're going to start playing with some of the adjustments. So, local adjustments. So we're going to go into this local adjustments tab here. And you know what, actually, before we do that, let's just make some quick lens corrections. So sharpness fall off, I mean, it really doesn't matter. There's nothing that we really need to worry about in terms of sharpness here, maybe hair up here. So no real harm in kind of adjusting this. Light fall off, again, you know, that's sort of vignetting. We can see if maybe take that to 50% or so. Again, it doesn't really matter too much in this particular case. And now we'll move on to our local adjustments. So if you've never used local adjustments before, they are, as the name suggests, adjustments that you apply locally to certain areas. And essentially those areas are just masked in like you would with a mask inside of Photoshop. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to create our skin adjustment because we want to get that skin looking as good as possible before we start to mess with other things. So let's just go ahead and create a new local adjustment here. We're just going to call it skin, and we're going to hit the B key for brush and the M key for mask. And essentially the M key just allows us to see the mask that we're painting on. So let's go ahead and zoom in here. And as far as your brush settings, you'll want to be at 100% opacity when you're doing this. And then hardness, you know, kind of up to you, but around 60 to 70%. And then size, depending on, of course, on the area that you're masking in. You can do this with anything other than lips, so you know your settings in terms of hardness will vary, but make sure that you're at 100% opacity, because ultimately what we're going to be doing is, rather than trying to select everything but the lips, we're going to select the lips and then flip it. If we were to do something like, for example, 50% opacity on the lips, if we flip that, we'll still be left with 50% opacity, because you know 50% is half of 100, and essentially just flipping it will give us back the other half. So let's go ahead and start painting here. It's not necessary to be, doesn't look like my mask is showing, so let's try that. Okay, there it is. Let's just undo that and start over. So I just hit the M key again. If it doesn't show up, just try hitting the M key again. Sometimes it doesn't kick in. So we want to be, you know, moderately careful with this, but you don't have to be super careful. Now, one thing that we do want to do, because the masks inside of Capture One operate more on like a flow basis, not an opacity basis like we see in Photoshop, you don't want to go over the same area twice. So like, don't raise your pen and then try and touch it up, because then you'll have areas that are more covered than others. Now, luckily we're at 100% here, so you know, it's not a big deal. If I start painting over this, I can't add more than 100%, but just be careful when you're at less than 100%. As soon as you raise your brush and you start painting over the same area, it will sort of build up quite quickly, and it's hard to get sort of an even mask. So try and do it all in one simple stroke. So that's good enough for our purposes here. Now, obviously you're thinking, well, that's just an outline. So you are correct. First thing we have to do is to fill this in. So we're gonna go ahead and go into this little three dot section over here, and we're just gonna say fill mask. And essentially that just fills in, you know, whatever loops you might have, closed loops, it'll just fill it in as a solid mask. So now let's go ahead and zoom out, and lips are looking great. We're going to go ahead and invert that mask. So as you can see now, that gives us everything except for our lips. And now, you know, as you can see, it's not perfect, but that's okay, because really what we're trying to do is we're trying to use the uniformity to make the skin look even. You know, if you've got a tiny bit of skin showing through here, it's not really going to make a difference. So what we really wanted to do is you know, just exclude the actual, you know, lipstick on the lips. So now we can hit the M key again to turn off the mask, because we don't really want to keep seeing it anymore. It's just, obviously we won't see what's below it. So hit the M key, that turns it off, and then we're going to go into skin tone. And let's sample a skin tone. So what you really want to do here is find something that is not, you know, too bright or sort of abnormally bright, I guess saturated, I would say, rather than bright. So something like your cheekbone here, obviously that has some blush on it. So you don't want to pick that, because it's really not representative of the rest of the skin. I usually find something like this, you know, around the forehead area where there isn't too much makeup product is sort of a safe bet. You don't want to select down here, because obviously there's highlights there and that will kind of throw things off. So, you know, usually somewhere on the chin, somewhere on the forehead is a good place. So clicking there, we've got our sample color as sort of a starting point. And now that we've excluded sort of that one thing that we don't want to change, we can really crank up the uniformity until we're sort of happy with how those colors have come together. So I'm going to take it to 0.8 in this case. And so we've got our lips still intact, nothing has changed there, but the overall skin tone has become much more uniform, much cleaner. And the next thing we want to do is play around with the saturation, because it's definitely too saturated at this point. So let's take down our saturation, and usually I find that it tends to be anywhere between like -5 and -10. You don't want to go too far with it, because then, you know, I find I tend to adjust it a little bit inside of Photoshop as well afterwards, so I don't have to get it perfect here. What I'm again looking for is something that's sort of a neutral baseline that will serve as a good starting point. So I think, you know, that looks pretty good to me. And as far as hue, we can always play with it. Let's see, do we want more greenish sort of hue, or do we want more of a magenta? Now, I'm not liking the magenta too much, and I actually don't mind it a little bit more on the greenish side. So essentially what we're doing here is we're just, as we slide the hue rotation, if you go minus, you're rotating this whole thing this way. So as you can see, you're going to be adding a little bit more green. If we rotate it this way, we're going more towards sort of magenta. So that's why you're seeing that sort of balance going there. So let's go ahead and just leave that at around, let's say 0.7, I think is good. So that's our skin uniformity there. And if we hold down the Option key and you click on the revert, it will just allow you to preview what's happened. So that's before, and that's after, and as you can see, you know, tremendous difference. And it's a good thing to do, because let's just toggle that off one more time. It's looking a little too green to me now that I actually look at the original. So let's just take this down a little bit to 0.5, so we don't quite go as far with that. Now the next thing I want to deal with is this area in the hair. And hair is one thing that I often adjust using local adjustments. And you know, there's two schools of thought on it. What we could do is we could create one flavor of this image where the shadows are really opened up globally and then mask it in Photoshop, or we can do it with local adjustments. Ultimately, it's entirely up to you how you do it. The one advantage of doing it with local adjustments is we don't have that one extra image that gets created when we export out to Photoshop. We're just left with the one image that has everything already combined. So for me, I tend to do it in here unless it's a very complicated masking scenario. Then what I'll do is I'll just go in here, you know, we'll open up shadows, maybe lift exposure. And as you can see, when you open up the shadows, everything looks terrible, but we get a little bit more detail in the hair here. So we would just mask in that area inside of Photoshop after the fact. But we're not going to do that here. We're just going to use our local adjustments. So I'm going to go ahead and create a new layer here called hair. We're going to call it hair one because we're going to do one more thing with hair. So in here, first thing I'm going to do is just go in and lift our exposure actually up a little bit more so I can see where that hair cuts off. Now, obviously, this looks terrible, but don't worry. We're going to just revert that back once we're done. So in hair one, again, hitting the mask key, B for brush, and let's go ahead and change our opacity a little bit here to 50%. And I'm just right-clicking to bring up this menu, by the way. And then for hardness, I'm going to want it, you know, maybe around 30% or so. And then we'll definitely want it a little bit larger. So we're going to just kind of go through this area here. And you know what? That feels like the hardness is still too high for me. So I'm going to take it down, increase the size a little bit. And let's try that. All right, that's good. And then I'm going to enlarge here. And again, you know, just trying to tie it into my previous one as cleanly as I can. And unfortunately here it has doubled up, but, you know, hopefully that won't cause too much trouble for us. That's the one thing I don't like about masking in here. It's difficult to kind of create a clean connection as soon as you lift your brush. So let's see how that looks. If we have to refine it, then we'll try and go through it again. And then we're going to again go in and fill the mask. One thing I do wish we had in the masking was a way to somehow blur the mask after the fact, like we can you know, in Photoshop using quick masks. But we have what we have at our disposal here. So let's just try and work with this. We'll hit the mask key again to turn off that mask. And I'm just going to go back and restore this to 0.4 in our exposure. And then let's go back in here. And we're just going to use a shadow slider to try and bring this out. So somewhere in there, all I really want is to pull a little bit of detail out there so it's not dark. Now, what I'm not liking here is this sort of line along the edge here. So what we can just do is, again, go to our eraser this time. Rather than using the brush, we're going to use our eraser. And we're going to go to erase, and we're going to have a fairly large eraser. We want it nice and soft, and maybe at around 30% opacity. And then we're just going to kind of go through here and take off some of that. And you can always hit the M key to see how you're doing. So as you can see, we've kind of faded this a little bit. And then I'm actually going to fade it a little bit from the back too, so it doesn't look too abrupt. All right. Let's try that again. And then maybe just let's erase a little bit more from this top portion. All right. So that is just a little bit more detail. Like I want, you know, some contrast in here, so I'm not going to push this anymore. Really, it's just a matter of providing a little bit of separation between the background and the hair. So that's that area. Let's go ahead and create another one. So we're going to call this hair two. And then again, hit the M key for mask, and we're going to bring back our brush. In this case, we're going to get our brush nice and large. And I'm just going to paint in this area right here. And what I really want to do with this area is just darken it down. Because this sort of creates this shadow, I don't really like the fact that we have a shadow here and then it's brighter here from the strobe. So we're just going to take down that exposure. And just hitting M key again, we're just going to bring down the overall exposure level there. There we go. Okay, so last thing we have to tackle is the chest area. So in the chest, obviously right now it's looking pretty bright. So let's go ahead and create another adjustment layer here. We're going to call it chest. And then same usual process. We're going to hit the M key to bring up the mask. We're going to go around here. And we're basically going to cut off with a soft sort of connection right here around the neck. and then kind of in these highlight areas. So we're going to do that. Let's just create a solid line here. All right. And opacity wise, I'm still around 50% or so that I had before, 46%. So, you know, I for something like this, I tend not to go at 100, but try and go about 50% plus. That'll, I think, give us a good sort of, you know, amount to play with. If you make it too low with the opacity, it won't allow us to do some of this recovery at enough of an impact. And unfortunately, you can't change the buildup of it after the fact. So there's no sort of, you know, going to 100% and then scaling back. It's unfortunately whatever you start with at the opacity, that's what you're stuck with. So then let's go ahead and paint in this area here. All right, and then we're gonna just once again do a fill mask. That's gonna fill that in. And again, if we have to kind of refine this by erasing some of it, we will, but let's turn off our mask and then we're gonna just recover some of our highlights here. We're going to, let's not nudge our white balance. And then let's take down exposure a little bit too. Maybe something like that. And just kind of keep playing with that. The reason I prefer to use the highlight recovery as much as possible for this is I don't really want to affect the luminosity of some of these hairs that are here. I just want them to kind of stay the same, and anything that is a highlight to sort of be tempered down. What we could do is if we find some areas still too bright, let's go ahead and lower our opacity to something like maybe 8%, and again zero hardness, and we're just going to brush in some of these areas here, right there and in around the neck right there. Okay, so if we look at our mask again, just going to get a little bit more buildup in these areas, and we just want that to build up slowly because we don't want there to be a noticeable shift. So any areas that are still bright, just keep kind of building them up. All right, so that's good. Let's go ahead and now use our skin tone color editor again. So we're gonna just sample the skin tone over here, and I'm just gonna pull in the uniformity a bit more just because I want that to be as uniform as possible, and there's really no other colors here other than skin. So let's just make this as clean and as even as possible. So now we're going to shift our saturation a little bit. This feels a little undersaturated compared to the face. So let's just balance it out right here. So we're just gonna nudge this up, +9, and then let's see if we want to go any one direction. So I don't think I want any more magenta in it, and I don't think I really want to go too much more on the green side, but let's add a little bit. I think that's good. And then let's take lightness down as well. All right, so let's just see what that's doing for us. Holding down Option and clicking the arrow here. As you can see, it's just darkening it down, adding a little bit of saturation just to match better with the face. And now that we've got that sorted out and we've been looking at the image for a little while, it's now starting to feel too saturated to me again. So that's kind of, you know, as your eyes adjust, your perception of the image changes. So let's go back to our skin, and I'm gonna actually lower this down a little bit more. So we're gonna just go from 7.7 back to around 9 here, 9 or 10. Yeah, I think that looks good. All right, and one thing to note here as well, let's just toggle this on and off. You can see the lips are unchanged, so we've got, you know, that color has remained just as it did before, but we've evened out our skin overall. So that's pretty much all we need to do to prep this image. There are no highlight areas. If there was, you know, harsh highlight areas, then we can mask in those particular regions there. For eyes, sometimes if the eyes are dark, I'll use a very low opacity soft brush and just create a quick stroke over the eye and inside the eye, and just use the shadow recovery to brighten that up a little bit too. Don't go overboard with that because then it starts to look a little bit fake, but just enough to kind of pull in some detail. If we wanted to, we can pull in some more detail maybe from these areas here, but overall I'm pretty happy with that as a starting point, and I'll show you kind of the final image out of Photoshop at the end of this video. So I hope you found that helpful. Some of the key areas that I really focus on are, start with the correct white balance and the uniformity for skin. If the lip is not really much of a problem, then you can use the global color editor. But if you have things like lips or eye makeup or whatever that is, has to be a certain color, or let's say you have a shirt that she's wearing that is red or pink in color and you want to retain that, do mask it out before you apply that. Do it using the local adjustments. So at this point, if we're ready to export our image, we just go into the process tab. I've created a PSD process recipe. I cover exporting in my getting started video, so I'm not going to cover it here, but we just, you know, hit process, put it out to Photoshop, and then we actually start our retouching on the image. So again, hope you found that helpful. Be sure to check us out on Facebook at facebook.com/vibrantshot, and also subscribe to this channel so you get more updates just like this one, and we will see you next time. Take care.